yourself the question, why would God start this thing in the first place? He doesn't need anybody. He's self-sufficient. He's very happy just being God. He's eternal. Why would he start it? Why would he start it? Not because he's omniscient. He knows what's going to happen. And so because he knows that the man that he's created will fall, it actually says in the scriptures, before the foundations of the earth was actually made, there was a lamb that was already slaughtered, representative of the Lord Jesus Christ. You've got to start to understand that God loves you. Whether you feel worthy of it or not, God loves you. He loves you so, so much. And life has probably kicked you in the teeth so much that you don't feel lovable. I want to tell you, God loves you. And when he touches someone's heart, he actually makes his people love you too. So we love one another. Amen? Anyway, I want to talk today about how to strengthen yourself in the Lord. There will be times on the sacred journey of life when you do feel burnt out. Have you ever been there? You feel burnt out, worn out. You've just had enough. Interestingly, this morning, so many said, you know, peace. And I'm sure you've said, oh, just give me a bit of peace. And I think sometimes we need a lot of peace. You know, we really do. But once you come to faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, it's vital that you grow in him and understand that his promises that are there in the scriptures, the promise, for instance, of the blessed Holy Spirit who will be in you and with you all the time. If you didn't hear anything else, right? Holy Spirit, the moment you come to faith in Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit resides in you. You will never be left alone. You might feel alone, but you're never left alone. He is always with you. I'd like to hear a hearty amen to that. Amen. Just to say that he is with you. But I want to say this, is that when you become a Christian, yes, there are lots of rights, and I hear lots of Christians quoting the promises and embracing the promises, but do remember, alongside those rights comes responsibilities. If any man will follow me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. There is a price to pay in being a Christian. Yes. But we have been promised the Holy Spirit, the Helper. Look, listen to these names. Holy Spirit, the Helper, the Comforter, the Guide, yes, the Teacher, who will lead you into all truth. The Spirit of Truth, the one who intercedes, the Advocate for you and for me. It's a wonderful gift that has been given to us. He, by the way, not it. It's he. The Holy Spirit has been given to each one of us. And so these are wonderful promises. But being a Christian does not in any way exempt you from the problems, the issues, the trials and testing, and even temptation. It does not exempt you from it. Amen?
Amen.
So in other words, some stuff will happen. Jesus says, take no thought for tomorrow, for tomorrow has enough evil of its own. Just think about today. And that's why I say to you, think about today. And if today you can look back on what time is it? 20 past 11. So far, I can only speak about me. So far, at half past five this morning, I was up. At half past five this morning, I had a couple of cups of tea. I need that at my age. A couple of cups of tea, a quick rush of caffeine. Right? And I put the recliner and just lay before the Lord. Lord, speak to me. Lord, this is what I'm praying for today. This is what I'm wanting today. Right? And so far, you know, I've come and I've joined with the body of Christ and enjoyed fellowship with the body of Christ and with the Father, with the Son, and with the Holy Spirit. And I've enjoyed taking Holy Communion, enjoying the praise and the worship and singing His praise and believing that He's doing me good as I praise Him. Amen? And He'll be doing you good too. And so it's all there. But life can, and very often is, tiring. And some issues, because they've gone on for so long, can be very, very tiring and leave you very weak and very exhausted. But didn't Jesus say something like this? Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Does anybody know what else it says in that text? It says this, it says, learn of me. For I am humble and gentle, lowly of heart. He said, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So if that is the case, we need to, if we are tired, we need to come to the Lord for Him to give us the rest, the perfect rest that only He can give. To quieten the internal dialogue. How many of you find that you have an internal dialogue, something going on in your head, and you can't get out? You know, especially, and you know, you say, especially in the dark nights of the soul, when things are going on, and you're worried sick, and you do, you're worried sick. That's what happens. Well, you know, we need to meditate upon the Lord. So this is again just an introduction. Psalm 84 in your Bible, Psalm 84 in Isaiah 54. Psalm 84 goes like this. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. Now, in the Old Testament, where was the dwelling place? Where was the dwelling place in the Old Testament? Look at the Old Covenant. It was in the tabernacle, in the temple. It was behind the veil. But Jesus died on the cross, and when He cried, it is finished, the veil in the temple was torn in two, symbolizing that not only now could the high priest go into the presence of Almighty God, but He was opening up the curtains for all of mankind. Every one of us to go into His presence. So it's this wonderful truth that we need to embrace, that we can come into the presence of Almighty God. He says, how lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. Let me just pause there. The dwelling place was in the tabernacle, but the dwelling place today is inside you and inside me. That God actually dwells inside each one of us. My soul longs, yes, faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh sing for joy to the living God. Even the sparrows find a home, and the swallows a nest for herself, where she may lay her young at your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God. Blessed are those who dwell in your house. Have you noticed in a lot of the epistles, Paul writes to the church and he says, grace and peace be unto you. Grace is the evidence that you live in God's house. Peace is the evidence that God lives in your house. Grace and peace be added unto you. And so many of you said this one, I want peace. Blessed are those who dwell in your house, ever singing your praises. Blessed are those whose strength is in you, in whose heart are the highways of Zion. Or in another version it says, who've set their hearts on pilgrimage. As they go through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. The early rains also cover it with pools. They go from strength to strength. Each one appears before God in Zion. Blessed is the man whose strength is in you. So we've got to find our strength in God. Now I'm just going to rhyme off some scriptures. Just throw them out there. And if you can, by your spirit man, grab hold of these scriptures. Grab hold of them and receive it to you, okay? Here's the first one. Psalm 46 says this. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in times of trouble. God is a refuge and strength, And in times of trouble, he will be your present help. Can anybody grab hold of that promise in the Word of God? You know, I'll have that one. I'll take that one. How about this one? I can do everything through him who strengthens me. I'm talking about the strength of God this morning. In Isaiah chapter 40, verse 29, there it says, he gives power to the weak and strength to the powerless. Again, it's a wonderful promise in the Word of God. You have to take hold of it. 2 Thessalonians 3:3 says this, but the Lord is faithful. Let me just pause there. What if you've been unfaithful? Does that change God?
No.
Great question. Again, you have not done it his way. You have not set your heart on pilgrimage. You have not actually walked on the highways of God. You have not done it God's way. Does that change Almighty God?
No,
for the Bible says that the Lord is faithful and he will strengthen and protect you from the evil one. Come on, folks, you need to get hold of this.
Amen.
Need to get hold of this one. 1 Peter 5:10. And the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. Mm-hmm. How many times have we been going through some stuff? And by the way, I've said we're not exempt from things that are happening. Right? We will go through some stuff in our lives. But if the presence of God is there, then things will change. It just so happens that you're going to suffer for a little while. Has anybody suffered for a little while?
No.
Please, somebody. You've suffered for a little while. But I want to say this, even though you've suffered for a little while, God promises, he says, I will restore you and make you strong, firm and steadfast. I just need to put my finger there for a moment. Let me tell you, right? I don't have to do this. I don't have to do this. I can retire, well, I'm retired, from, you know, as far as the world is concerned. I receive a pension from the government every month. So I don't get paid to do this. I don't get paid. And you know what? It's hard work. Mm-hmm. You might say, well, you know, it's not that hard, John. You know, all you do is stand up there, you sing a few songs. And, who do you think writes all these notes? How many hours do you think I spend writing these things? I do get tired sometimes. When I go home from service, you know, and I've been served for a while, you know, as you get a little old, you forget my back. You see, you know, it's like that. But listen, there's a reason for doing it. I've actually found that in life you've got to have a noble purpose to live for, something to live for. I don't want to retire and get in my recliner and watch the TV or goodness knows what. I want a noble purpose to live for. And what is a noble purpose? The noble purpose is got to be for the greater good of me and for the greater good of mankind. In other words, I have to live for the noble purpose of being good for me, but being good for you.
Yes.
And in being good for you, I'm hoping that you will rise to something better than you were yesterday. That today you'll be something bigger, better. And that which actually ensnared you and troubled you and caused you pain, I want to cause you to become an overcomer, to beat that thing which has been beating you. Enough is enough. Is enough. And so, let me come back to this. Where was I reading from? And the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you suffered a little while. You know what? I do know what it is to suffer. And there's some things you will never ever know about me. And by the way, you've got things that no one will ever know about you. And you keep it to yourself, but you suffered. God's promise is this, is that he will restore you, make you strong, firm and steadfast. The sufferings that I've gone through have actually made me stronger. I don't know who said, if it doesn't kill you, it makes you stronger. I know it's not scripture, by the way, but I want to tell you, it didn't kill me. In actual fact, it built character. It made me stronger, having gone through that stuff. And we all go through stuff. I like this one. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in the time of need. Did you not get hold of that? We've had somebody who's actually who took on flesh and blood and walked this earth. And he was actually as man God intended man to be, and he was without sin. But the book of Corinthians says this, he said it made him who knew no sin to become sin, so that we could become the righteousness of God. Yes. This is wonderful stuff. And here there's an invitation. He says that you can boldly approach the throne of grace in your time of trouble, that you might find mercy and grace to strengthen you. The wonderful invitation where you can come and you can ask and seek and knock upon heaven's door. Lord, I need you today. How many of you are to do that and play, you know, knock on the door? Lord, I need you today. Lord, I need you in my marriage. Lord, I need you with my family. Lord, I need you with my finances. Lord, I need you with my health. Lord, I need you with my neighbour. I need you with knocking on heaven's door. Yeah. I want to tell you, he hears you. He listens. And he answers, by the way. He answers our prayers. And then coming back to Psalm 84. Blessed is the man whose strength is in you, in whose heart are the highways of Zion. Passing through the valley of weeping, they make it a place of springs. Yea, the early rain covers it with blessings. They go from strength to strength. Every one of them appear before God in Zion. You have to set your heart upon something. And I want to encourage you this morning to say, set your heart upon something noble. Be better. If you'll forgive me, be better than a fag end. Be better than a bottle. Be something better than that. Have a noble purpose. Get up in the morning and breathe the air and realize that the Spirit of God is in you and you're alive. And you're about a noble purpose. And that is the kingdom of God. How am I going to do this? Lord, I'm quite tired, I'm weak and I'm burnt out. What's the best thing I can do? Isaiah 54 says this, sing. Sing, O barren, you who are not born. Break forth into singing and cry out. You have not labored with child, for more are the children of the desolate than the children of the married woman, says the Lord. Enlarge the place of your tent, and let them stretch out the curtains of your dwelling. Do not spare, lengthen your cords, and strengthen your stakes. I want to tell you, God is speaking to us there. He's saying, when you weep, sing. When you weep, cry out. When you weep, sing out aloud to the Lord. The first thing you have to do is you have to give a shout. Yes. Amen. Now, I'm not stupid. I know people. And I don't say that in a clever way. I know faces. I know personalities. I'm quite a quiet person. You probably don't think that, but I am. I like to be on my own, especially in the morning. I like at least an hour, you know, before Margaret gets up. I just like to be on my own. And that's the way I am. But not everybody can shout. But there is something that we need to do if you want to break the barrenness. Read Psalm 84. Let me just turn to it. Psalm 84. I want to do this real quick. I'm so sorry, I don't mean to talk to you for too long. But he's talking about strength. Blessed is the man whose strength is in you, whose heart is set on pilgrimage, as they pass through the valley of Baca. Now, what's the valley of Baca? Baca means the valley of weeping, or the valley of barrenness, where things are not happening. happening for you. Things are not going your way. The circumstances are different. But if you set your heart upon God, you can you have the opportunity to reverse your response to the circumstances that you are experiencing. Where there are tears and fears, you can experience, the psalm says, springs. And springs are always symbolic of the blessing of God. Ignore whoever's outside. Pay more attention to this. Jesus comes along and he says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he's anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He sent me to bind the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and to the opening of prisons to those who are bound, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, the day of the vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn. Instead of ashes, the oil of gladness. Instead of mourning, the garment of praise. Instead of the faint spirit, that they may be called the oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. In other words, if you're tired this morning, you need to praise him. You need to make a noise. And you're not the type of congregation that actually would shout at the top of your voices. Well, one or two of you are. But you see, my wife, she's not one for shouting. She's quite a quiet lass. But I'll tell you something, you can break something this morning. You can break that barrenness in your life. You can break and become fruitful.
Glory.
You can change, you can reverse what has been a curse upon your life. Just in a moment, just by a shout. On what authority are you saying that, John? On the authority of the Word of God. It says, shout, cry out, say something good about God, and something will start to happen in your life. You will go from barrenness to fruitfulness. Yeah. My friend Ted Hansen, please believe in me, has got such a gift. There's been ladies, honestly, countless ladies, who have not been able to have children, and he's prayed for them. And within a year, they got pregnant. By the way, Ted's with us in August. And Margaret's going, woo! I'm telling you, this is a wonderful thing. You can go from barrenness to fruitfulness, yes, with a shout. A shout.